Thank you for coming tonight. This is very exciting. This is our first POG event in this space, which is 326 Gallery, which began the courtesy of Stephen I, who you may know from Solar Culture. He's been running that for 40 years. I do think it's that long. Steve I is the manager of this entire complex, which houses artists, tattoo artists, massage people, all kinds of wonderful and things you need, I'm sure, in this building. And he offered the space to me to build a gallery, and I said, okay. So since May, this is our third show. Since May, we've had about Yeah. 60 artists have shown their work in here. And there have been some sales, mostly to each other, but slightly we're branching out now. And we have great hopes for the future. No fees, no commissions. This is not a business plan. Don't go to the Eller School and tell them what we're doing. That's not going to happen. There's just so many good artists in this town. It's hard to see them not get their work out in front of people. So that's what we're trying to do. And the east side is particularly deprived of this kind of activity. It's mostly happening downtown. And people out here, they don't know how to park downtown. They don't know how to get there. They don't know where to go. So now we're here. Okay, so now you know. Now that you found it, wasn't that easy, I know, because the address is Wilmont. We are not on Wilmont. We're on 14th. Still, somehow, here you are. So thank you. And thank you for coming to the first POG event of our season. We have the pleasure of having Michael Davidson here from California. And I'm so grateful that he's here, and I feel like so lovely that he can share what he does with all of you, because his likes don't come by that often in our little burg. I'm supposed to acknowledge support. Yes, we do get some support from the Arizona Commission on the Arts, Poets and Writers, Jack's Press, the Poetry Center, the English Department, Arizona Quarterly, and individual donors. So if you have extra money laying around and you'd like to see poetry keep on, we're happy to relieve you of that. Our, as soon as the pandemic hit, there were all these grants, oh, you're struggling, we'll give you this money, we'll give you that money. And you kind of wondered, like, where was all this money before me? Right? And then, we got a lot of money and we did a lot of things. And, we started doing Zoom readings and, raised the honorariums to art. I mean, it was really great. Well, that's over. Right? Because there is no more pandemic. You all know that, right? Charles went to China and he was informed that COVID, there is no COVID in China. There is no COVID.
Even though I had it in China.
So here we are. So we're coming along. And like most nonprofit organizations, the bulk of our monies comes from people like you. That's the way it is. It's that same way for Channel 6. It's the same way for all kinds of arts organizations. So anything you want to help us with is appreciated. Our patrons, which is looks like reading the list, our board. Sponsors, Nancy Schock, Joan Larkin, bless her heart. And if you want to donate, you can go to pogarttucson.org online, and we have a way that you can give us all your money or some. We also have on your chair tonight this little questionnaire. And it's helpful to us to understand who our audience is. So if you'd kindly fill that out and any other notes you want to make. Now, you're also invited, besides the event tonight, on Monday at the little chapel on campus, which is a sweet spot to go, between 4 and 6 p.m. on Monday, you can hear Michael talk more about these issues about disability and poetics and the conversation about these things, which is extremely interesting to all of us, actually, right now. So, whether you know it or not, you're going to learn something. And thank you so much for coming. Please come back.
Thank you. I'm another one of these POG people, and I'm briefly, the order is strange here because of what we're trying to do. I'm going to briefly introduce Michael, but then I'm going to announce that we're also having a little in memoriam for Jerome Rothenberg, who's been important to many people here. even people I know that haven't had to do with poetry. I talked to an artist last week, didn't realize Jerome Rothenberg was a poet, but he knew the book Shaking the Pumpkin, which had been essential to him as an artist in his career. So, Michael Davidson has been for many years, I think he retired after 40 of them, at the University of California at San Diego, where not only is he a distinguished professor of American poetry, but he helped build the collections and archives at UC San Diego, build the Archive for New Poetry, which has been a key site for housing and preserving the poetics of the most, to me, the most essential American poetries that maybe began in the middle of the 20th century and continue to this day. He is also the author of, I think it's 8, might even be 9 books of poetry now, and most recently his collected and new poems, and he's also written several books of critical prose, including a book on the San Francisco poetry and community in San Francisco in mid-century, meaning the last century, which is also involved with movements like the San Francisco Renaissance and the Beat Poets and the Black Mountain Poets and others that either were in San Francisco or came to be there. And even the beginning of, by the end of that period, a new and kind of essential feminist poetics that came out through things like the journal, however, which is a little bit past what Michael's writing about, but that's already. I think he is a poet who is absolutely precise in his language that he also lets go to be absolutely crazy, but in a way that keeps us turning in that gyre, that keeps us right there. I just want to read one thing from one of his poems, which says something about poetry. And this is from a poem he wrote for David Brummage, Analogy of the Ion. David Brummage, another one of those Bay Area poets. And he writes at the end of it, and I can see this as involving what Michael is all about too. He says, "Do you mind if I share your table? Poetry lifts the veil from the hidden beauty of the world and makes familiar objects be as if they were not familiar. Death is a condition, not a promise." Okay, now ordinarily I would say please welcome Michael Davidson, but I'm not, because we are going to talk a little bit about Jerry Rothenberg. Jerome Rothenberg was lost to us in April of this year, 2024. He was there when most of us began, if not before we began. He was there through, as the compiler of anthologies that have been essential from that Shaking the Pumpkin I mentioned, or even earlier, America, Prophecy, Technicians of the Sacred, the volumes that came in more recent decades, the Poems for the Millennium, which has included a wide range of poetries of the world, including one anthology is barbaric, vast, and wild. And Rothenberg taught us that the wildest of our poetries and the most audacious of our poetries are connected essentially to all of us. And I think everybody I know that knows his work feels like they owe him an incredible debt. We were lucky we had him as long as we did. And I think some of us here can attest, as generous as he was in bringing the world all that, he was equally generous as a human being to other people, whether they were his friends or people he had just met. So I'm going to read three things. None of them are long. And Tenny Nathanson is going to read one piece by Jerome Rothenberg that was first, well, I don't know if it's first published, but it was published in a 2001 anthology of POG presenters. So, you know, we also claim him just a little bit. So this one is from an interview, and it's been something that has propelled me for decades. He says, "I think the challenge of poetry is the breaking down of the notion of simple truths, the literalness of the word, the notion of fixed commandments of behavior and morality sent down from heaven, the notion of an exclusive culture that could dominate another, the divine right of kings and the not-so-divine rights of the affluent and comfortable, the notion that God is with us and that these divine revelations we hold to be self-evident are equally true for others. The only absolutes for poetry are diversity and change and the freedom to pursue these. And the only purpose over the long run is to raise questions, to raise doubts, to put people into alternative, sometimes uncomfortable position or situations, to raise questions but not necessarily answer them, or to jump ahead with other questions, to challenge the most widely held of preconceptions in our culture that Western man is the culmination of the human evolutionary process." Okay. That's from an interview, and it's reprinted in the book Prefaces. It was originally published in San Diego Magazine. One of my favorite books of Jerry's for a long time, this is a much earlier book. I mean, in his career, it's probably the middle of it. It's 1976, now it's pretty early. And it's published by someone who was one of my mentors when I began, Carl Jung from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and his Membrane Press. And it's also, because we're in a gallery, I thought it was right, because it's in memory of Wallace Berman. Some people know about him. So, "Vowels and consonants cry out in every language, help! A dream. The alphabet came to me in a dream. He said, 'I am alphabet. Take your light from me.' And I thought, 'You are numbers first before you are sound. You are the fingers' progression, and you end in the fist, a solid mass against the world.' But the alphabet was dark. Like my hand writing these words, he rose not as light at first through issuing from light, but fear, a double-headed body with the pen a blacker line at center. A began it, but in Hebrew, not a vowel. A choked sound, it was the larynx, stopped the midrash, said contained all sound. Sound of alphabet, initial to all speech, as one or zero. Called it work of creation in my dream. A creature more than solid, more than space or distance. And he said, all numbers and all sounds converge here. But I knew it. Said that I would count my way into the vision. Grooved thus with numbers and with sound. The distances to every side of us. As in a poem."
So I can't remember, there's Guys and Dolls, it's the largest something permanent floating crap game in New York. Does anybody remember? Right? So POG is the largest permanent floating crap game in Tucson. We've been going since 1997. And it's wonderful to have Michael back here. He was part of like POG the early years, gave a wonderful reading around the turn of the century probably, and also he gave a wonderful talk for Arizona Quarterly. And Jerry Rothenberg, as Charles says, was already, was also here as a part of POG in the early years. And so he graciously gave us a poem for POG 2 from 2001. So this is from his A Book of Witness. There's an epigraph, Maria Sabina. "Language belongs to the saint children. They speak, and I have the power to translate." So section 83 from the book. in the way words rhyme. In the way words rhyme or fail to, I found my truth. I walked through little parks, elated, crooning. In the parade of angels, I was first to start. My life bled through my skin. I was connected to the moon by sonar. What I couldn't get a grip on, I discarded. Sooner than slip back, I let the wranglers ride me. I felt my jaw disgorging every word I spoke. The smell of mackerel was the greatest poem. America was promises. I thrust my hand in yours and yammered. Miracles came cheap and fast. I beat myself with nettles until the flesh fell off. I made a rhyme of womb and slaughter, filling in the empty sounds.
And now Michael Davidson, but first he will say a few words about Jerome Rothenberg.
Well, it's really nice to be here. The POG series is famous around the world. No, it's true. I'm very honored to be part of this series. It's also an important time to think about the loss of Jerry Rothenberg, who was a great personal friend. You know, April was the cruelest month for many of us because we lost not only Jerry, but Lynn Hajinian, Marjorie Perloff, Tyrone Williams. It was a bad spring, but the loss of Jerry was personally very hard for us. We live in San Diego and Jerry lived right up the road, so we spent a lot of time with Jerry and Diane from the time they arrived. And Jerry was kind of the center of the whirlwind. Everything that was going on in San Diego in the arts swirled around Jerry. He made things happen. He and Diane, I want to mention how important Diane Rothenberg, who is still with us, praise God. And their house was kind of the place where we gathered when anybody came to town, and there would be a big dinner, and Diane cooked an extraordinary number of enormous dinners for all of us. And it was the only salon that we had. In their modified San Diego tract home, which they turned it into a Bauhaus extension. So we got together with them a lot, and I remember many events at their house, but one in particular was the bar mitzvah for their son Matthew, which was kind of a showcase for performance art. Pauline Oliveros, the composer, played the accordion. Alan Capro did a performance. David Anton did a talk piece. The big Jewish band played klezmer music. And Matthew knew his prayers. So it was a great event. And it still is being talked about by those that are still left. But Jerry was a generous and sweet man. He was somebody who was so kind. He was unlike a lot of poets, I have to say. He actually asked questions of how you're doing. He thought about how your health was. And so when he was ill towards the end recently, I went in and sat in the care place. He was flat on his back. He'd had a very bad fall. And we read, I read to him, and I felt I needed to pay back for all of the kindness he had showed me over the years. So it was very, very sad to lose him. He was, of course, a formidable poet and translator. I don't need to tell you. He published over 80 books. He was translated in many languages. Everybody knew him, and yet he was this intimate, focused, kind person with this sweet smile and humor that we will miss this. So I have a short poem. I'll begin with a short poem for Jerry called Technician for Jerry Rothenberg. It's so quiet here, you could hear a chickpea drop. The finches are whooping it up, setting up shop in the mulberry where there's enough room for everyone. Down the street, the bins stand at attention, waiting to be dismissed. April has been arrested, taking from spring and its otherwise raucous chant that voice that sang, "We are birds made of fire. Our light is a voice." So I'm going to read a few poems from this kind of selected poems called Bleed Through, older poems. This is called The Second City. Even though there are motorized conveyances, I am on foot. Even though there's a map, I negotiate the streets by landmark. There are no landmarks, but a series of edges common to several cities. The Hill is in San Francisco, the great shopping district with its glittering windows and esplanade before the fountain is in New York. And the river with its bridges is in Paris. I'm working on the park with its glass botanical gardens, marble pillars in the distance, left over from the exposition. There's probably a hill from which I descend and arrive at the market district below, clearly indicated by the word brick, like those on the west side of Buffalo. To make this descent is to parse the terrifying grid of hill cities, roads dead-ending against canyons, barriers, where a street careens into space and continues below, bearing the same name. So that a second city rises out of the forgotten one, more pointed because not yet filled in by monument or palisade, the place where water touches land and forms a line, the leaf-like veins of streets. It is too late for the bus, and I must walk from North Beach to the Bronx or something with a B through the middle city, the place a middle occupies when you are no longer familiar, and the buildings have only been seen by night from a car and by lights. I'm afraid someone will address me in French and I will forget the word for myself, having so recently arrived. And yet to be a stranger is to be swallowed up without words, without glasses, bearing an envelope with a numbered series. In the second city, I live out the dream of the first, living neither for its access and glamour, nor dying from its disregard, simply talking toward the twin spires of an ancient cathedral, like a person becoming like a person. I'm deaf, and I have very good hearing aids, so I have a little bit of hearing. For some reason, maybe it's the hot weather or something like that, my hearing has gone in and out, so I find myself reading, and then I lose my voice. So if you can't hear me, raise your hand or something, because it's a little uncanny. This is called The Terror. It was written before Donald Trump, but I think it has application. When we come full circle to the rose garden in the imaginary, we'll remember the terror, the names whose crimes are invented in order to have something else to kill, the king's absent face at the window across from the dock, the names of the trains that run on time for the first time. I think of this when I read of the stupidity of princes with breakfast. By midday, the stock market has made one of them rich, and part of my breakfast has bought his lunch and paid someone to espalier his roses across an adobe wall. They never die. The pronouns become so malleable, they refer to anyone, but never oneself. Something must be exchanged for the privilege of joining a word to its source. Something must not fit for its replacement to be the wrong size. Then the terror begins in the hot weather when they drain all the pools and the bidding wars keep them empty. The contractor who will inherit the earth is figuring out how to do it even as we speak. Just listen. One of the people... See, there my hearing goes again, just disappears. One of the people who most admired Jerome Rothenberg was Robert Duncan. And this is a poem called Transmission that I wrote for Robert. A forest or a field? Am I in the reading or is it reading me? Light through the fence, vapor lifting. Into the clearing for a better look. A lake that turned into a meadow. First field, first fealty. Then I learned how to read errancy, tracing the lips moving before the sound forms. Which eye sees me and which the wall behind? Which bear is a weir bear? The unutterable cadence as a wave or train swept up in these intentions of light, a soul living through speech. Then came the age of the tape recorder. No word is crossed out. Everything lives and is holy. Seeing across Lake of the Woods, I was more than myself. I was called sight. Exasperation with the luggage, with the tickets in the multiple pockets, with the electrical connection and its instructions, more than himself speaking. Metal iris casts multiple yellows on a round table. In its halo, an occasion for company, the cut glass vase, the pewter creamer among the company, present and speaking. This is another, this poem is called Translation. It's a rough translation of Baudelaire's Le Cygne, the Swan, but it's a really rough translation. Against the black sea of a black night, a single light of the duty-free shop blazing on a broadcast horizon, all the drowned sailors are restored by its siren. Desert becomes lawn. Old neighborhoods are an allegory one steps through. The predictable and repeated windows filled with the glass of novelty that by wearing become new as a pilgrim arrives refreshed in Jerusalem. I think of you, hapless shopper, stepping through mirrors with a map of Troy, only to find yourself frozen in representation, like a swan in Audubon. Dead sweaters roam the aisles, searching for lost husbands. Within the cloacal streets of the old city that gather like phlegm in the throat, new boulevards form in the mind of a white architect nearing the end of a life spent among the dark consonants, the mass. We would be signs dragging once snowy plumage through ravaged construction sites that progress raise visible portions of itself to explain the benefits of speed, the violet frisson of acceleration. Where was Africa? Someone in an office of tusks on the 14th floor asks, and in the absence of palms and musk, a museum of masks retains these black distances behind protective glass. In the aisles of exile, I think of forgotten sailors who search the horizon for a solid thing, when wings are signs of harbor, frozen like script in azure, and bring back junk for the stalls. These next poems are from a, oh, there we go, that's good. You'll see the changes in my behavior. I apologize for that, but it is slightly weird to have, you know, have this happening right now. This manuscript tentatively is called Grace, and it's inspired by the line from Frank O'Hara's poem, In Memory of My Feelings, Grace to be born and live as variously as possible. I think it's a great line, and as a person who has lost his hearing, I think of that experience as a kind of grace. It's given me a chance to live variously and to think very differently about sound, voice, orality, facial expressions, space, vision. All kinds of things have changed for me as a consequence. So a lot of these poems are attempts to deal with the experience of not understanding things very well and making mistakes, and also validating mistakes as a generative experience that we all must celebrate, because we all make mistakes and we learn from them. Not all of the poems are about that specifically, but I just wanted to give you the background for the book. This one's called Cenotaph. It's like an urn. A death in the family takes the form of this form. What follows is outside the frame, since events refuse the categories they are given and chatter back from the grave at the indecency of their memorial, like the small notebook in which one records the dream that never quite coincides with anyone, yet bears a striking resemblance to D or M, who appear in cameo roles along with the spaces since we last met. A dark bar in Vancouver, the park in Perugia, memories of misspent youth etched on this cenotaph. One dreams is my own. I too lived in Leucadia, among the palms and condos. Midway on this highway, I was interrupted by the body that consumes everything. It was a dark wood. I was a small death waiting to be born. This is called Apophasis in Public. Apophasis is the rhetorical figure that we use where we sort of, damning with faint praise, we say, I don't want to say anything bad about that person, but he's really a jerk. That's a little stratagem. You give a little bit of positive and then you really knock it back. But I'm talking about a very specific political figure that you'll probably figure out. In the interest of fair play, I won't say anything too critical of this surd who occupies our speech. This is one way of avoiding the fact that we hide in signs of assurance the germ of our extinction, and we fail. But failure is a kind of renewal, even, and this is the exciting part, another occasion to talk, despite the crash of other voices and music in the background. What he means by that cannot be verified by any appeal to its subject. A cadaver is also meat. Blue is a shaded green. China can be reinvented as the latest version of ourselves, where our means not me. Cigarettes were lit, lights dimmed when we were social. Now there are no more cigarettes, rooms, or conversations. If is a tunnel into wood. If he appears at the scene after the fact, would he have caused it, or would have, wearing such dubious clothing and distinctive hair? The less of us on the street, the more he occupies space and the words in between. The ASL sign for Trump is this. This is called, oh, there it comes back again. Maybe I should just stop reading. It seems to come back after the end. This is called, I'm having one of those Saul LeWitt days. Nothing on the inside, nothing outside. Fuchsias drip over the redwood box. Numbers fit into place as things, and things are more than their corners. That reference to the hammer has been useful, but impractical. Send me the bill. Poussin pink hovers over Marine Corps base, small puffs of smoke rising from the fake Arab village. This transcription will begin in a moment. Errors should not be attached to a person. Sky and sea converge at the horizon where the idea of speech begins. I love speech, so many boxes to fill. Pencil. Remember the pencil? A yellow inducement. And the blank page, remember that? Now filled with letters and spaces of little interest. The more they arrive and fill in the blanks with their endless palaver, the more a sky resigns to be its mirror. The page remains alive, alert, says, try again to erase that dream, that offense of youth. Try again the stylus by which we forget to grow old. Remember? Stipulations. You must think we are absolute idiots, dolts, naives, patsies, enablers, Pollyannas, for the way we have handled our youth, your youth, their future, his likelihood of, and appeared to endorse trickle-down normative gender racial stereotypes under the umbrella of tolerance, self-interest, empathy, financial accountability, while supporting redistribution, free speech, slow food, indigenous rights, that are being co-opted by social media, free speech, neoliberal repayment, under the guise of fairness, accommodation, consensus, rational choice, because you require us, we feed you, reality sucks, people have lost touch. And in another life, we wouldn't be having this, we will forget, you'd move back home, we'd be dead. Where? We had a choice. Fate hadn't delivered a bad hand. You suddenly got it. We could go on living, perpetuating this oppressive relationship, eating rich food, and not think any further about qualification, unanticipated events, monsoon, suicide bombers, the gun lobby, that your outrage, repressed feelings, lies, subterfuges, late night sweats have reinforced in our insecurity, muted anger, resignation, that we depend on if our youth, your youth, their future, his likelihood of we're to live together, emigrate, share our resources, keep on talking. I think that covers everything, right? This is called Rooms after James Castle. James Castle is a wonderful deaf artist who never spoke and presumably never heard a word, and spent his life near Boise in a rural part of Idaho, drawing the buildings on his property. There was a barn and a shed and the house, and he drew the windows and then what he saw through the windows, and everything was very rectilinear. I mean, he was like a classic modernist. The grid was very prominent, but he never had any formal artistic training, and he never went to school and didn't exhibit. And of course, now there is a James Castle house, and you can actually go and do research there. He's a wonderful, wonderful artist. And when people use the phrase naive artist, or what's the other word they use for untutored arts?
Primitive.
Or outsider.
Outsider, right. Well, he was an outsider for sure, but he wasn't naive, I'll tell you that. Rooms. Using a pointed stick, soot, and spit, he drew interiors of sheds, outbuildings, coops, shelves, and rafters forming the grid, and through doors or windows looked back and out into Idaho. He never spoke, nor apparently heard, but in shades of gray made structure speak back. He liked to work the milk separator. This section of the book is called Drone. It begins with an epigraph by Christine Sun Kim, who's a wonderful deaf artist. She says, grammar is on your face. And it's true. In ASL, of course, the face, facial expression, is a morphological element of the language. And if you raise your eyes, you may be asking a question. And if you look down, you're making a statement. And I'm very moved by the idea of grammar being removed from the text onto the face. And so these are poems that really explore deafness, my relationship to deaf culture, to sign language, and so forth. My audiogram. Have you all had an audiogram at some point? You'll appreciate this. My audiogram must sing in the night, fragrant decibels, jasmine, lilac, a river of pitches, rustles below the bridge. Kyrie, begins in the bases and rises into the invisible credo. Notes are text of distant listening. What they say is beyond me. Big, not pig. Cat, not hat. The body enters the social in a stave of differences. Ghosts, has an epigram from Henry James' story, The Jolly Corner. Quote, he's none of me, even as I might have been. Ghosts don't talk so good. They mumble and gibber, especially in restaurants where the acoustics are terrible. They once lived in bodies of language, words etched on tongues we could read. Everyone cranes their necks to see them at the next table. But they're on the other side of seeing. We want confirmation of what they want, possessed, as they say, by a word that escapes us. Echolalia. I'm thinking here about a great book by Daniel Hiller Rosen called Echolalia, in which he talks about lost languages, languages that disappear. But he's particularly interested in the language of babies. The babble of babies is very complicated. It's full of all the sounds of all the languages of the world. And little by little, of course, the sounds you don't want them to speak are removed. And so he meditates a little bit on the lost language of babies. And those, they're still there. An unused phoneme drifts into memory after the barbarians have come from the north, or precedes the name of God in one of the forbidden books. We scream at the checkout stand. It stops a crying child. A child crying utters the name of God by the watermelons. I used to love the body that now speaks through hands of uncertain gravity. Retrieve, restore, the sign for back, and the pinched Adam's apple of curiosity. And the absent corpus, its multiple orifice, a vessel of succor. No sound, wound, could not be spoken, no pain unaccounted. At night, one shouts at the memory of lost flesh, lost songs, the lure of their retrieval, like the distant H, a ghost of breath, once holy body, now a distant glacier, melting into air. This is called Destroyed Pitch. One of the things that was most disturbing to me was my inability to hear music anymore. I couldn't distinguish pitches, and I was a lifelong pianist, so this was very disturbing. But this is a kind of a meditation on trying to hear a Mozart quartet, the Prussian quartet. Between a rock and a second rock, ticking on a reef, A becomes F, or harp equals glockenspiel. I love difference that flattens into billiards clacking on an infinite felt. Memory says the opening bars ascend in thirds. But how to know when pitch drowns into throbbing water? One is under sound. That little downward figure, or the trill just after the opening, when the dotted notes return to the main theme. No wonder Prussian, the king was a good cellist. Cantabile in the lower registers that rumbles in the inner ear. Shock absorbers on poor alignment on a rough road. Where is pitch when it dies in a field of undifferentiated timbre? These clinks and rumbles come back in silence with sound. I just heard the little waltz in the second movement for a passing moment. Drone. A robust and boisterous clamor from noise in pitches against this gray drone where bleak departs from fleck or belt. Inflection is a distant horizon. I cook peppers interrogative is not I cook peppers, yet they stay inflecting air. In 3 weeks, this steroid panopticon stares back at a largely visual display, with the occasional pop of a door or ping of some timer telling me fish. A phantom stands oddly poised in the doorway, oddly human. So that verbs fall away, why use them to describe motion when objects fall on your head and make a hollow noise? The drone captures silence in its slithery net and disperses water around the cochlea. The shell hears the sea, they say. But humans are phantoms holding money and desire through conversation. Their shirts crinkle with gladness, their skirts rustle in a novel. The sex scenes used to be on my side, now they lie on the page hugging the margin of a once body, now mannequin. Waking in fog, padding down to the machine, I dream of tires rumbling over macadam, cherries crunched, and Janacek, intimate letters, so quiet without pitch, yet vigorous in pursuit of dance and nation. I defer to those clanking guts that growl in the lower registers and claw their way through the exotoses to the coil and then to Idaho, dream of diving into clear water over milfoil to swim in a rhythm of one stroke. This is intimacy one speaks through, and reciprocated makes a noise. The body is a hollow, and words flower, follow, as if you're having a conversation with yourself. It's a gray alphabet, but you get to choose. Cockroach. This poem is riddled with verbs. One hid under the soap dish, another troubles my sleep. They have survived millennia of disrespect and volcanic eruption. The fig died this summer. We're thinking of replacing it with, because life can't be suppressed by a simple reference to God. You need to take a walk, see the rocks, big as buildings, example below. And it all connects to something I forget which. The poet wants us to feel something she has experienced, like Vesuvius or grilled figs and ham. Fog came in this morning, buoys at 7 second intervals. This is an example of odd attentions modified by rhetoric. I can't find my key. I can't hear the timer. And the last part of the book is called Grace, and it begins with a final quatrain of a poem by Emily Dickinson. The soul selects her own society. At the end, she says, I've known her from an ample nation, choose one, then close the valves of her attention like stone. Leviathan begins with an epigraph by Henri-Jacques Steiker, who was a historian of disability, one of the great historians of the long history of people with disabilities. He says, the field of mutilation extends indefinitely. I was sitting under this blue image requested by the reviewer and saw in the distance a green forest. I'll stop now and consider distance as a kind of affection, something that sticks to something else, affliction, for example. If only he would provide us with an object, these mutations would seem less arbitrary. But once you remove a leg or arm, you instantly think of how to put it all back together in your own image. And society mumbles approval, strengthening resolve. You could do pathos as a backup and have empathy in time for tea. The body extended becomes Leviathan. Everything under heaven belongs to me. I won't fail to speak of his limbs, his graceful form, etc. From this remove, we witness the red sun setting in a comfortable painting that has never known weather. And these Euclidean dresses on the Grand Jatte enclose their wearers as water becomes the medium we breathe. I know it's a stretch, but bodies tend to stop at the edge of image and blend into each other in an impasto of affect. You can't see all of it from here, but move along its flank, piecing together the flesh you left behind with the image of flesh before you. They want you to return the damaged body to the library of disappointments so it can disappear in the general catalog this image sustains. A monster rising from the hills, his body a mosaic of faces turned away. We only see the giant face of power over the commons. This is called Absent. Absent, as the sound of conversation in an adjacent room, is an index of affection shared across a table among strangers, eliciting concern for filling the space of an hour until the rain stops with the ambient noise of glasses, footsteps, doors closing, and someone shouting over the din, and the rain coming down on the skylight, preventing night from coming inside and disturbing this drone of sociality that serves as a measure of this matter of attention. And this is called social media. Because something is always out of alignment, causing pain to someone stuck on the 101 on their way late to the dentist offering respite from unfulfilled expectations at an early age that continue into this lane where everyone else drives one of those silver cars, so you can point out that an infraction back in the 1970s caused irreparable harm involving a ruptured disc or Protestant letter in that journal still nagging after all these years, and of course said person is still alive and to all appearances successful while living in a town with no visible means of support. No wonder the water is unsafe to drink. At least we have recourse to shared community and discussion, untroubled by ego and self-conscious oblivion. I'm a little cynical about the advantages of social media, and I realize I'm probably in the minority, but there are moments when it seems to control everything. Well, I'm coming to a close here. I'm not sure what our time is, but is there time for a few more? Just a couple more? Okay. This is called Speechless in Gaza. I remember my parents had a book on the coffee table called Eyeless in Gaza. Well, this is Speechless in Gaza. According to Kierkegaard, the fog came in around 7 o'clock and lasted all morning. The crows were squawking in the pine trees across the street, hawks circling. Neighbors were anxious. According to the news, the baby in the bombed hospital is a lyric subject. No one hears him as anything but retribution. This is what silence sounds like. Dread is the long memory of error embalmed in alabaster, until night when it returns with tales of past misdeeds and crimes. Let's destroy a city and let suffering live. Let's repeat the rhyme and remember Zion. What's it like to be a thing? Scraps of foreign phrases in a white bowl, a scarf, the satin kippot for special occasions. One of these targets can be found on Amazon. The crows caw, amassing data, which they freely share. They don't exist. Their goal is the egg. We who exist have these words. Why the hawk circles and the crows cry. This is what it means not to be a thing. And I'll conclude with this poem, which is called Redemption, and it has an epigram by Fanny Howe. Devils stroll with angels into our daily lives. In the crepuscular hours, they crowd out the blood, searching for unmarked graves of unmarked elders. They hardly had time to forget their mistakes before being held to account by their children or an idea of their children. that keeps him awake, provoking desire for light, heat, and the paper's comforting columns. With death on the right and suspicion on the left, I once knew an angel who died and lives in a city up north. I once knew a devil who lived and continues to speak in the hours before light of what's lost and what's not. Thank you. For those of you who need this technology, this is called AVA, A-V-A. It's a captioning app that's pretty accurate. It makes really interesting mistakes, too. So, but it helps me in conversations. So any remarks or questions you might have?
When did you start lose your hearing?
Almost ready to hear.
Who said that?
Richard said, when did you start to lose your hearing?
I began losing my hearing in about 1995.
Gradually?
Gradually, yeah. And so I kept on teaching, but one of the advantages of having hearing problems in the classroom was that then I then had to come out in the classroom and stand right next to the person and say, well, could you repeat the question? Which meant that everybody else got to hear the question that they didn't hear in the first place.
Yeah.
And so it was a very much more pedagogically rich experience for me. But then it got to the point where I needed a captioner for everything, you know, faculty meetings, and I figured that's it. So after 40 years, I retired. And then it's funny, the retirement coincided with pretty serious hearing loss. Right now, I have just a tiny bit of hearing. And if I have my hearing aids out, nothing. So it was gradual. But it's good that it's gradual, because then, you know, you assimilate the experience. Each time you learn a little bit more about things. And I'm learning sign language. I'm pretty slow, but improving. Other questions?
I'll talk to Charles so he can type.
Okay.
Although I'm very loud. I was really moved by your admission that you used to play the piano and that you lost your hearing and you've lost pitch. But it's your poems are so rich in sound and mm-hmm. in pitch and in texture. It seems to me that you've internalized your music.
Yeah, I mean, sound doesn't go away. It's still locked in other parts of your sensorium.
Yeah.
But I do think that I really indulged in a lot more verbal texture than I might have otherwise done. So thank you for observing that, because it's quite true. And of course, a lot of the weird poems, the ones that are really make no sense at all, are just attempts to put stuff together and reach for textures. One of the prominent things that happened when I had this sort of drone of tinnitus for a long time was the feeling of billiard balls on a felt clicking. That sound was it was a sound that when I went swimming in the ocean, I could hear sounds through bone conduction, mm-hmm. and it sounded like billiard balls clicking.
Yeah. Just sort of a nice sound.
It's a nice, it's a beautiful sound.
Clicking.
Yeah. Yes.
When and how did you begin writing poetry?
When and how? You're asking me to go back a long ways. Well, I think we all had an aha moment where we had a good teacher who looked at something that you wrote and said, oh, that's a poem. And this would have been in, middle school or something like that. But I mean, the really serious commitment to poetry happened in college. And then I went to University of Buffalo, where it was back in the 60s, was a big poetry world. Charles Olson had been there. Robert Creeley was my dissertation advisor. Robert Haas, former poet laureate was on my committee. There's lots of poetry there, and everybody wrote poetry. It was a very heady experience, and lots of readings, and so the sheer volume of different options were open to developing a poetics. But it was, like my hearing loss, gradual. Yes, David.
I was wondering if you could speak a little bit more about error and mishearing, and particularly how that involves how you actually approach writing a poem.
Well, that's a really loaded question for me. My recent book is called Distressing Language, Disability and the Poetics of Error. And I really wanted to talk about error as a productive aspect of my life, that when you have trouble understanding things, you learn something about what people expect you to do. And it made me think a lot more about other kinds of people whose speech is problematic. The migrant who has an accent, the person with a stutter, the person with neurological damage or cerebral palsy, and so forth. And so we say that this is bad speech and so forth, but of course that's a misunderstanding of what speech is about. You know, speech is something that we it's about desire. It's about wanting to reach others, to have connection in whatever form. So I got interested in the mistakes that this captioning program makes. They were so interesting, and they reminded me a lot of Gertrude Stein's poetry. So in the book, I have a section where I quote from dinner table conversations that were pretty weird, and I interlace them with passages from Tender Buttons by Gertrude Stein. There's not much difference. And the reason isn't that Gertrude Stein made mistakes any more than, but this is natural language processing. It's an AI technique, and it's searching around for the syntax that's appropriate to what it thinks is going to happen. Well, I think Stein was interested in that too, but not to get it right, but to get it, maybe to get it wrong and make it interesting. So I found that aspect interesting also. The other side has a lot to do with what Jack Halberstam calls queer failure. And I think there's an equivalent, and queer failure means, well, you know, if in a heteronormative society, to be queer is to be a failure. You haven't lived up to your heteronormative possibilities. Well, it's true for CRIPS. People with disabilities are also, quote, failures in a world that privileges autonomy, independence, hearing, whatever, sight, rationality. And so I got interested in failure as a political move to think a little bit about how we divide up the world in terms of successes and failures. And we have to start honoring error, failure, mistakes, and misapprehensions as part of knowledge. Every scientific discovery is based on displacing a preceding error. And that's really fundamental, I think, to the process. Tenney.
I was going to ask something about the interrelation in your work between mordancy and tenderness. And it feels like that has something to do with what you just said in response to David.
Between mordant and tenderness?
Yeah.
Here.
Last line.
Which one? This one?
Yeah.
Mordancy and tenderness. Can you say more about mordancy?
Yeah. Well, there's a very super smart irony in your work that is full of enjoyment. And then that modulates really quickly into something really soft and tender. And I don't know, it feels like that has something to do with what you just said about error and responses to how error is treated. Yeah.
Well, I think it's embarrassment, frankly. You know, you go out on a limb and you say, oh, I shouldn't be here. You know, I'm going to think about something else. I'm worried about statements that go too far in the direction of pathos, or that go too far in the direction of, I'm really going to stick it to Donald Trump in this poem. And so I want to back off, because it's not so interesting if we know what the antecedent is all the time. That's what the Frankfurt School called instrumental reason. And it's also, what did Louis Zukoski call it? Predatory intent, where the poem has always got to have, you know, even if it's abstract, it's going to point the finger at somebody. And every time I find myself pointing the finger at somebody, I really have to step back. And so I think that's, and so irony does become an important vehicle for that. That's, that is the trope that we use. And maybe I use it too much, but I think there's a side of irony that, that is tender and gentle, and a way of allowing another person in, as opposed to saying, you're not my reader. I don't want you reading my poem. Yes.
I encountered your work when I started to write about disability too. And I'd known your criticism, but less your poetry. A theorist who was also a poet, Hilary Gravendyke, up in LA.
Great.
Yeah, another loss. She writes about time and disability, and I'm forgetting the term, but with hearing loss, there's more isolation, there's more silence, and there's a going within. And I wondered if you have noted that in your work. It seems so interior at times. Mm-hmm. I'd like you to talk about that a bit.
There's one poem I didn't read, but it addresses that exactly. Loneliness and isolation are, you know, one of the conditions of life that happen for lots of reasons. When you get older and you retire and you no longer have a instant contact and gratification of the classroom, maybe, colleagues. But certainly my social life has shrunk dramatically because of hearing loss, because it's very hard to sit at a table with a lot of yammering people. The ASL, the deaf people have this sign, big mouth. A bunch of people sitting around the table, big mouth. Just, you know, just talking. And then the other side of is the sort of the fact that you don't want to dwell on that isolation. What you want to do is to sort of nurture the isolation, get something out of it, write more, for example. But it's difficult, I have to say. There, isolation is a bit of a problem, especially if you're in a hearing world, and no one's making any concessions. They're not speaking so that I can read lips. They're not using their Ava. Does that address what you were saying about Hillary?
Yeah. Well, I'm curious at the evolution of your relationship to time as you lost your hearing and poetry. I'm just curious.
Yeah. You'll have to tell me afterwards what you've been writing about the poetry and disability. John.
You're using lots of quotations in your work that sort of set the stage for many of the sections and many of the poems themselves. And so a question I had that's sort of related to all these questions was, how's your reading changed in relationship to your hearing loss as well?
My vocal reading?
No, you're not your vocal reading, but your actual just reading on the page. How has that changed? Has it changed?
Oh, you mean this kind of reading?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
As well as reading sort of broadly imagines, too. What new things are you reading because
of
this?
You know, we're always looking for examples to support how we're feeling about things. So I certainly looked for figures of disability in literature, and I taught courses in disability studies, so I was always having to make a bibliography out of, and I would ask people, I want to talk about sight impairment, what would you suggest for that? So my reading is, the actual reading of books and texts has changed pretty dramatically because of that. I want more support. So yeah, we should talk about what we're reading. But I still like long novels. You know, I haven't stopped reading Henry James, but I've discovered a more a disabled Henry James, because you know he had very severe rheumatism, and his rheumatism was so bad that he had to hire a typist. And about the time What Maisie Knew, which would be late 1890s or so, or before that. So he began typing, I'm sorry, he began dictating his novels, and he got used to the clicking of the Remington typewriter. And in fact, he was so used to it because the rhythm of his speech began to imitate the clicking of the keys. And then when the Remington broke down and they got a spare, he couldn't dictate. So he's really dependent on this. So it's interesting to think about those long sentences, highly subordinated sentences that go on forever in The Ambassadors and Wings of the Dove and The Golden Bowl, as having something to do with an oral recitation brought about by this very severe arthritis that prevented him from writing longhand. Now there's an additional interesting fact that I just learned, that James had a stutter. So think about that. To what extent was the delays and hems and haws, the delaying action of a person with a stammer, to what extent did that have to do with the development of his prose style? So what I'm saying here is, of course, once you start looking through a disability optic, mm-hmm. you begin to find a disability narrative, a subterranean narrative in lots of different works. Emily Dickinson, I love Emily Dickinson. We all love Emily Dickinson. But she also had vision problems, and she was partially blind when she was young, and she had an eye operation, and she wore a mask over her eyes to help her eyes. So all the time, when she says, "I could not see to see, and then the windows failed, I could not see to see," you know, was that a reference back to that time when she was blind? So that's what I mean by a disability optic. Mm-hmm. It's right there. It's to me, it's very much the way that all cultural groups who come into political awareness realize, you know, look how women were treated in these novels. Look how queers were treated in these poems. So yeah, it's very helpful.
Couldn't you expand that and say everybody has a disability?
Who's speaking?
Richard, he said, could you expand that to say that everyone has a disability? Or every writer has a disability?
Well, I think we need to make a distinction between saying, well, we're all disabled, you know, if we live long enough. Because this disrespects the disability rights movement that has been, you know, activist in getting accommodation and getting the ADA passed and so forth. But we do have these experiences of mortality in the body, and the history of aesthetics has been a tendency to remove the body from aesthetic works and to think of the artwork as this pure monad, as Theodore Adorno called it, and leave the body aside. But the body's always there, and so reading through the, maybe I shouldn't say reading through disability, but reading through the body brings up a different text. I'm kind of interested in artists whose work I like, and it turns out that they're form of embodiment or sensorium is important in the shape that their work takes. There's a very good exhibit of Chris Bell's glass sculptures up in Phoenix, and these are big tinted glass squares, rectilinear shapes, large. And then at the end of the show, there's a series of little miniatures, little boxes like that. Nothing in the show would suggest that. But then I read the little card, and it turns out that Bell had developed later in life a degenerative nerve disease. And it didn't necessarily change the medium, because he used a lot of the same materials, but it changed the size of his endeavor. He now was working in a much more intimate way. These were small things with more referentiality in them. Mm-hmm. That's very interesting to go to the museum and see that. Mm-hmm. Real revelation to me. Mm-hmm. Well,
draw to a close and say
thank you.